I think that there are at least two reasons that there is excitement. I think that the people who are in the Orthodox Church of Ukraine that belonged to either the Kievan Patriarchate or the Ukrainian Autocephalous Orthodox Church found themselves in the same camp as the Ukrainian Greco-Catholic Church, really for since World War II, after that period of time where historically speaking, if you look at the literature, immediately after Yalta in 1945, the Soviet Union used the Great Patriotic War to claim first that they had liberated West Ukraine from fascist Nazi tyranny, and that they had reunited Ukraine that had been divided. And a part of that propaganda was to attempt to blame especially Greek Catholics, but also autocephalous Orthodox bishops for collaborating with the Nazis. And that's something that never completely went away. In fact, you're seeing a sort of resurgence of what's organically Soviet propaganda that's being spouted not only by propagandists on the side of the Moscow Patriarchate, but even propagandists who simply hear this stuff and believe it without fact-checking it. They've been put in the same camp. So for example, Crimea and Donbas, the Moscow Patriarchate has officially blamed the Greek Catholics and the former autocephalists and Kievan Patriarchate for creating a political climate that led to this war. They're saying that it's their fault. And so they've been put in this opposing camp all of this time. Now, for people who don't know the history, one of the things that is simply not developed enough in terms of public discourse is the phenomenon of the Maidan. This movement, this event, this experience of claiming once and for all dignity to build a Ukrainian future together. If you read the scholarly literature on the Maidan, this is a transformative experience. And in the beginning, both Greek Catholic and Orthodox scholars were critical of their own churches, saying you didn't have a strong enough response to the people on the Maidan because first you just called for some kind of peace to be created between the Yanukovych regime and the protesters on the Maidan. But what I think we saw, what we witnessed to, was that when the protesters basically said, "We've reached the point of no return, we will no longer stand for corruption, we want to build a future that's based on values such as nonviolence, anti-corruption, democracy, openness, and especially, above all, human dignity," that it was the Greek Catholics and the Kievan Patriarchate that took the most visible action in expressing and demonstrating solidarity with the people on the Maidan. And so what you have here is a sort of a glue that's created between Greek Catholics and these autocephalous. And it's very important to note that there were clergy of the Moscow Patriarchate on the Maidan, and you can find evidence of Metropolitan Onufriy sending a very strong letter to Patriarch Kirill in 2014, asking him to intervene to stop the aggression against Ukrainian sovereignty. So I'm not trying to leave out the Moscow Patriarchate, but if you ask almost anyone with knowledge of the situation, it was primarily Greek Catholic and Kievan Patriarchate clergy who demonstrated their solidarity with the Ukrainian people. And so, in a certain sense, what we're seeing now is that the future of Ukraine, this post-Soviet future, kind of casting off the scales or shackles of the Soviet and also the imperial legacies, is going to be one that's done together with people who are working together. And one really important element here is that the Greek Catholics have not enjoyed a dialogue with the Moscow Patriarchate. It's been more a spirit of hostility between those churches. And this is all about the pseudo Council of Lviv in 1946 and the forced liquidation and the role of the Moscow Patriarchate enforcing the Greek Catholics to self-liquidate their own church and to become what the Ukrainian scholar Natalia Shlikhta has called subalterns, by drawing upon post-colonial language. So in that time period, autocephalists in the Kievan Patriarchate and the Autocephalous Church and the Greek Catholics have enjoyed dialogue. And what I think they see here with the Orthodox Church of Ukraine is a spirit of, from this point forward, we're going to be doing this together. From the Orthodox perspective, I think it shouldn't be confused with we are on the road to resolving the schism between Constantinople and Rome, or the Orthodox Church in Rome. It's going to take that. That's a different story. There's no doubt that the people who have participated in the Kievan Church study group have come up with groundbreaking proposals to attempt to begin the process of resolving that schism, and those should be taken seriously. But I think we have to understand that the Orthodox Church as a whole isn't quite ready to take that step yet, mostly because the Orthodox have to work out their own internal differences with one another. But I think that what we're going to see here with Ukraine is that this dialogue will actually be sustainable and could be productive and constructive to being able to share resources to do good things. Now, one of the things that I've already noticed is the expression of hope on the part of Ukrainian intellectuals who are in the Orthodox Church of Ukraine to create an Orthodox version of the Ukrainian Catholic University in Lviv. And that just shows you how the respect that these Orthodox intellectuals have for UKU and the work that they've done in really providing first-rate, top-shelf academic training for their students, both in the theology schools and in all of the other programs that they offer at UKU. So I would share in the excitement of Professors Kravchuk, Father Chirovsky. I think that this could be the beginning of a long period of sustainable dialogue that's going to bear fruit for the faithful, but really for the entire people of Ukraine. They can only serve to benefit if the churches are actually working together than if the churches are only working in their own self-interests. And the presence of Patriarch Sviatoslav yesterday, his participation in the enthronization ceremony, the Divine Liturgy at Hagia Sophia in Kyiv, is significant. The fact that he was invited and participated in that event shows that's a kind of a visible symbol that they're going to enjoy this dialogue moving forward.